You would think the end of the world would be a one-time event, but the end of the world is a regular occurrence for many of the inhabitants of our planet. Extinctions happen all the time, and we see that in the fossil record. Which makes it weird when that fossil record also seems to show a pattern in those extinctions. Or at least that's what the data in the 1980s showed. And that data is why the researchers Mark Davis, Pete Hutt, and Richard A. Moeller proposed the Nemesis theory in 1983. Their theory is surprisingly simple. The Sun has an undiscovered binary partner called Nemesis. During the closest point of the star's orbit, it would nudge objects in the Oort cloud, leading them to travel inward, causing mass bombardments and impacts on the planets of the solar system. The 1983 paper, Periodicity of Extinctions in the Geologic Past, posits that most mass extinctions the last couple hundred million years seem to follow a roughly 26 million year pattern. Extinctions happen for many reasons, but it's hard to think of an earthly means in which an extinction event could occur on such a consistent cycle. Massive volcanoes? They can be consistent, but they don't last super long, and there's usually evidence. Diseases are out of the question. And habitat collapse caused a lot of extinctions, but what habitat collapses every 28 million years? The paper states, though the causes of the periodicity are unknown, it is possible that they are related to extraterrestrial forces, solar, solar system, or galactic. They further support this claim by referencing another paper, Evidence in the Crater Ages for Periodic Impacts on the Earth. That paper finds that large impact craters show up periodically every 28 million years. A number that, if you noticed, is quite close to the other one. So we know two things. Mass extinctions and meteor impacts seem to happen on the same periodic cycle. Comets don't move on their own. Sure, some of them will orbit around and sometimes hit us, but not in a cycle, and not in large numbers. Something has to be moving them for that to happen. That is where the Nemesis theory comes in. Most stars are actually born in binary pairs. Some lose their partners, others don't, so there's a decent chance that at least at some point in the past, our sun had a companion. Binary stars tend to orbit each other at relatively large distances compared to planets, meaning that this binary partner of the sun would have a very long orbit, probably around 1 to 1.5 light years long. During the closest point of Nemesis's orbit, its gravity will start to nudge objects at the very outer edge of our solar system. The very outer edge of our solar system is called the Oort cloud. The Oort cloud is a big repository of comets and other detritus from when the solar system formed, and it is really far away. So far, in fact, that it's just barely in the solar system. They are so loosely held by the sun's gravity that they don't really orbit, they just kind of float. And because of this, any outside influence can cause them to go haywire. Anything from the motion of the galaxy to the gravity of a passing star or just a random impact can either send them hurtling towards the solar system or free them from the sun's grasp and send them into the wider galaxy. So, if all these objects are at the outer edge of our solar system and can be nudged by anything, then all Nemesis needs to do is just kind of show up vaguely. Its gravity just has to barely tug on them, and those things will get dislodged from the Oort cloud. And some of them will be free, and others will go hurtling inwards. And the ones sent hurtling inwards are the ones we gotta worry about. Nemesis would dislodge so many things with its substantial gravity that it would cause mass bombardments and impacts on all the planets of the solar system. Combine this with a stable 26 million year orbit, and you have a recipe for comets constantly hitting everything in the solar system every 26 million years. It's a pretty good theory, and everything seems to line up. But there's just one problem. If our sun has a binary partner, where on Earth is it? Or should I say, where in space is it? The writers of the original paper did acknowledge the lack of an apparent second star, and argued that it could be a brown dwarf or potentially even a black hole. Other researchers at the time also suggested that it could be a red dwarf. Red dwarfs are the smallest of the true stars, and thus are very dim. In fact, no red dwarf stars are visible to the naked eye, so it would make sense that a potential red dwarf companion had not been discovered. No one would have been able to see it during human history with the naked eye, and it was only until recently that telescopes started noticing red dwarfs in large numbers. The same applies to brown dwarfs. Brown dwarfs are essentially gas giants that are just big enough to fuse some elements, but not big enough to actually fuse hydrogen and helium like stars. They produce very little heat, and glow very faintly. It also would be impossible to see without a telescope. Both brown dwarfs and red dwarfs also are very small, which would make seeing them even harder. The last one is a black hole. By their very definition, you cannot see a black hole, so it makes sense that no one's found a black hole companion yet. All three of these objects fall under the category of something that could not be seen without contemporary technology. Even with the technology from the 1980s, they still had not surveyed the entire sky or everything close to the sun by that point. So something small and dim could have slipped by unnoticed, especially since no one was looking for a star close to the sun. So if Nemesis was theorized all the way back in the 80s, why aren't we hearing about it now? Well, that's simple. It's because it doesn't exist. Nemesis as a theory never really took off to the point where it became a mainstream idea. It gained some traction, and people certainly were looking for it. But the idea that the sun had an undiscovered star companion that we just hadn't noticed is kind of hard to accept. In the years since the paper, several full sky surveys have been conducted in multiple wavelengths of light. If Nemesis existed, it would have been seen by now. There certainly is a chance that it's been unnoticed, but it's not likely. The NASA WISE mission has confirmed that there's nothing larger than Jupiter within the closest 26,000 AU to the sun. Nemesis would be farther out at about 100,000 AU, but Nemesis would also be bigger and be generating light. Basically, if WISE didn't see it, it probably doesn't exist. There's still the black hole option. If there is a black hole Nemesis, we wouldn't have seen it. And there is a very small chance that there's a red dwarf or brown dwarf orbiting the sun still. NASA even says, quote, "It is still possible that the sun could have a distant unseen companion in a more circular orbit, with a period of a few million years. One that would not cause devastating effects to terrestrial life." The real nail in the coffin is the fact that the Nemesis theory is no longer needed. As technology improves and we get more data, what might have looked like a cycle in the 1980s no longer does in the 21st century. The same NASA article from earlier also says, "Recent scientific analysis no longer supports the idea that extinctions on Earth happen at regular, repeated intervals. Thus, the Nemesis theory is no longer needed." We don't need the Nemesis theory anymore, because it's the solution to a problem that never existed. However, Nemesis was probably real in a broader sense. Most stars form with a binary partner, and many of them separate, so it's quite likely that our sun had a partner at some point. Maybe it got separated? Maybe it's still floating out there undiscovered, like the NASA article says. This benevolent companion star even has a different name. The same article says, "To distinguish this object from the malevolent Nemesis, astronomers chose the name of Nemesis's benevolent sister in Greek mythology, Tyche." So yeah, there might still be a binary companion to our sun that hasn't been found. It's not likely, but Tyche could be out there. As for Nemesis the murder star though? Yeah, probably not. Thanks for watching. See you next week as I endeavor to have a consistent upload schedule.